In this video, we'll look at how to run a Dockerized application and relational database like Postgres easily on Google Cloud. When we set up an application like this, we'll need some sort of runtime for the container itself, and we also want ways to deploy, manage, and scale that application easily. Kubernetes is definitely the go-to choice for that. Specifically, we're going to use Google Kubernetes Engine Autopilot for a really turnkey and simple way to run that Docker container. We also want our application to be able to use the database in a pretty seamless way, whether that's something like Postgres, MySQL, or SQL Server. So we're going to use the Cloud SQL service for that application's database. As a simple example application, we're going to use the Kanboard project, which is an open source, traditional application written in PHP. It doesn't actually have a Kubernetes-based installation path, but given that it does have a Docker container and the required configuration points, we could still install it on GKE Autopilot and Cloud SQL. Now, just running the container and taking care of the database is only part of the challenge here. We also want to make sure that we're setting up our networking in a really performant and easy to manage way. We'll address that through our GKE Autopilot, which will provision and manage some cloud load balancing on our behalf. This is what's going to back our ingress resources in that GKE Autopilot cluster. Additionally, a production-grade installation of an application like this should probably involve things like an SSL certificate or HTTPS connections, as well as a custom domain. To be clear, we'll only really have to set up a couple of simple things in GKE and Cloud SQL to get this set up. The resources at the front here are managed by our GKE cluster automatically. Note that in the Kanboard documentation, if we go to Running Kanboard, we can see some of the installation details. We've got options for different databases that we can use, as well as traditional VM versus Docker installation. There's no Kubernetes or Helm-based installation approach. However, since this application is Dockerized, we can certainly run it in a production-grade way on Kubernetes. We'll refer back to this documentation when we start to set up the application. In our project here, let's first go to Kubernetes Engine and then set up our Autopilot cluster. Since we have a completely new project, we'll enable the API. Then we'll click to create a new cluster. By default, we'll get the Autopilot cluster configuration instead of the standard configuration. We can largely accept the defaults here and just change the name. Note that this is a managed experience, including nodes and node pools. We're just going to be providing our Kubernetes resources, and Google Cloud will take care of the rest. We don't need to configure node pools, associated auto-scaling, and machine-level details. We can also set up our Cloud SQL instance. Your application will dictate exactly what this setup looks like, but in our case, we'll run a simple and small Postgres database. For our application, let's choose Postgres 12. In case we need it later, we'll grab the admin user credential. We can decrease the cost quite a bit by choosing things like a development versus production type instance, meaning some lower availability and smaller options for configurations. For example, we don't have high availability. Then we'll choose a lightweight instance with just a single CPU and about 4 GB of RAM. We can even go cheaper with the shared core instance types, but for our application, a CPU and 4 GB of RAM should be fine. The default SSD choice should be sufficient for our storage type, and we'll set the capacity at about 20 GB with automatic storage increases. An important setting is how we want to connect to the instance. Since we're just connecting to this database from our Kubernetes cluster locally in this project, we're going to choose a private IP and select the network that we have for the GKE Autopilot cluster, which is the default network. Enabling private services access connects Google's managed networks, like the one used for this database, with our project networks. The simplest approach here is to use an automatically allocated IP range, and then we'll go ahead and create the connection. Continuing right along, note that there's a different set of configurations if we choose public IP accessibility. We're specifically going to leave that disabled. All the other settings seem fine here. Note that by default, we are getting some backups, which we will end up needing to pay for. You can price out these database instances by using the Google Cloud Cost Calculator, which is linked in the description of this video. This configuration should be less than $100 a month. With that, let's go ahead and create our instance. While that's provisioning, let's go ahead and create our code in a new GitHub repository, which we will share in the description of this video. The resources file here is going to have Kubernetes resource specifications for how we want to run this application. Specifically, how we run that is going to be very dependent on the instructions for the Docker-based installation for this application. If this is your own custom application, you'll know the configuration points and probably different file paths that you need to persist with volumes, but for this application, we can infer that from the documentation. We need to make sure that we have at least the data and plugins directories as volumes. We're actually going to use the Google Managed SSL experience, so we won't need to mount an SSL directory there. Beyond that, we'll probably need to provide some configurations, maybe in terms of environment variables, and on the Kubernetes side, possibly even config maps. This gives us a good idea, and there are actually tools like Compose that will convert our Docker Compose files to Kubernetes specifications for us. For example, with this project, we could get a starting specification for how we should run this application using Compose. It will take a specification like this in Docker Compose and output a Kubernetes resource file. Now, that's typically going to be a pretty rough starting point, but it is a starting point nonetheless. So let's start bringing in some of these resources following the instructions on that Docker-based installation page. The first thing we need is a deployment. In this deployment, we're just going to run a single replica. Sometimes for your Docker-based applications, they're not really built for auto-scaling and have issues with concurrency, so sometimes you'll need to specify a single replica and a strategy of type recreate to ensure that you never have more than one instance running. That's pretty common with more traditional applications that are Dockerized, such as this Kanboard example. From there, we have a pretty standard boilerplate type deployment specification. Here we're going to specify the latest image from Docker Hub for the Kanboard project. We'll need to provide a database connection string, and then we're mounting some volumes, as well as some config maps. So again, this is a PHP application, and we're just going to mount a couple of configuration files so that we can specify those externally in our Kubernetes resource file. Now with Autopilot, if we don't specify resources like CPU and memory, it will assign some by default, but we rarely want to use those defaults. We probably know what kind of CPU and memory we need for the container and should specify that explicitly. So now let's define some of these persistent volume and config map specifications. So first, we have the data persistent volume claim, and note that we're specifying a premium read-write-once storage class for the data here. We wanted to add this just to show you that we can have some pretty easy specification of different types of backing hardware, even though we're using this really turnkey Kubernetes service with GKE Autopilot. This is saying that we want SSD storage to back this particular persistent volume claim. We're using the default storage class for the logs persistent volume and the plugins persistent volume further down. We also have some config maps for external specification of longer configuration files. Of course, the application that you're trying to run will dictate the type of configurations that you need, but it is somewhat common to see both configurations supplied as config maps for large configuration files, as well as configurations provided via environment variables for more succinct specification of configurations. If you're building the image yourself or customizing an image, a third option would be adding the configurations to the image itself, but we'd like to use the official Kanboard image directly here, and so we'll avoid like that. All right, so let's go ahead and deploy this out. Notably, we don't have any kind of service or networking set up yet. However, it does make sense to deploy this out first. We'll change the default admin password and check our configuration before we start exposing the application to the public internet. This is also going to give us a check of that SQL connection. Speaking of which, we hopefully have a completed provisioning here in Cloud SQL, and we do. So we can just add a couple of things that we need before Kanboard can use this database. Specifically, let's create a new user. We'll generate the password, but use a little bit fewer special characters in this one. Let's also create the database here. All right, all set. Let's now use this for the connection string environment variable in our application. We do need to grab the IP of this Kanboard instance as well. With that, we've got a nice connection string for Kanboard, and now everything is pretty well specified for our Dockerized application. Let's get credentials for that Kubernetes cluster that we created so that we can deploy this out. The kubectl getpods command ensures that we've got a good connection, and then let's go ahead and apply that resources file. Now again, because we're not managing nodes or node pools directly, there's a lot of work that Google is doing on the back end here to dynamically provision the capacity that we need, so the container provisioning can take a little bit longer than you might be used to. But we'll hang tight here while this pod gets scheduled and then starts to run. Once that container is in a running state, the logical next step is to get the logs for that container. The logs aren't super helpful, but they are coming up fine for us. Things generally look pretty good, but let's further check the installation here. First, in our SQL interface, let's complement that container log check with our SQL server log check. So we're not getting a whole lot of logs here yet. That could be because perhaps we have not yet accessed the application, or it's just taking a moment for the logs to come up, which should be fine. Let's go ahead and do exactly that, access the application. Even though we don't have public access set up yet, we still can access the application by using kubectl port forward. We know that this application is running on port 80, so we'll do a port forward to the pod here, and specifically run it on port 8080, forwarding to the container's port. We'll even specify that we can access this from any address using the port forward, but this is just going to be available locally here. In our Cloud Shell, we can use the web preview here, and we've got our Kanboard application coming right up. Now, this application has a pretty simple default username and password, so while this instance is not publicly exposed on the internet, we probably want to change that login. Otherwise, this is looking pretty good. We can, for example, create a new project, and then we have that project here in our Kanboard application. We now need to layer on the networking in front of this deployment. So this is going to involve just a couple of additional resources. Working outward from that deployment, we have our service, which is going to be running on port 80 in front of our Kanboard. This is essentially just a bit of networking abstraction around our containers and pods, and it's pretty lightweight. We then have our ingress, which is really the core resource here when we're specifying the ingress class and, in this case, providing a static IP, front-end configuration for HTTPS redirect, and a managed certificate specification, where we'll be using a custom domain that we own. So before we can run this, we do need to set up that static IP and also point our domain to that static IP using a DNS A record. Let's do precisely that. Make sure that the names match exactly in your IP specification and in your Kubernetes resource. We do need that IP type to be IPv4 global. We're going to take this IP and, in our DNS provider on a separate screen, create a record for that. Okay, so we've pointed kanboard.notomatic.io in our DNS to this IP here, and we have all the networking pieces that we need now to provision this additional set of resources. While that creates, we can jump back into our SQL to check the system status. We can see things in our System Insights page like our CPU utilization, disk utilization, and even connections. Note that there was pretty high CPU utilization when this instance started, but it has since come down quite a bit. So far, this is looking like a pretty oversized instance, but potentially, as this application starts to be used more, the sizing here could be appropriate, and we can auto-grow that storage as needed. Let's check in on our ingress resource here. Overall, this is looking pretty good. It's creating lots of load balancer components, as you can see in the events here. We can even check those out in the console. The critical path involves a somewhat slow provisioning of our certificate, but that shouldn't be more than a few minutes. We do have one last thing that we need to fix here, which is that we can see 0 of 1 healthy for our backend services. So when our load balancer is trying to make sure that our application is healthy on the backend, it's seeing some sort of issue. So if we go back, we're no longer port forwarding here. Let's go ahead and do that again, and we'll check the homepage to see what kind of status codes we get. This is a good way to sanity check that our application is serving status codes in the 200s for our application homepage. Again, we'll do a port forward and then use that web preview to be able to see our application. Let's log out here, inspect our traffic, and then go to the network tab just to make sure that when we hit this root domain without this login, we are indeed going to get a 200 type status code. Note that it's actually rendering us to this login page, so that's probably the issue here. We can verify that's indeed the case by running a curl on our local host to port 8080. We'll probably see that redirect with a 302 status code. So basically, the load balancer is getting a non-200 type status code. It's getting a 302, and then assuming from that our backends are not healthy. Let's fix that, and that's going to be a pretty easy thing to fix. It turns out that this particular application needs to use a customized health check. So just like we had the front-end config before, let's add a back-end config now. I just brought in some code from the GKE documentation, and the only thing that we need to customize here is the path. So let's change this to login, and then we just need to apply this back-end config to our load balancer. This will actually be an annotation in our service. So, for port 80, we're going to use the Kanboard backend config. This looks pretty good, and that should update our health check so that we are indeed routing to our application. If you're in control of the application itself, and it's a custom application, you could potentially have this route actually serve a proper page, maybe a health check, but it's nice that we have some configurability across a number of dimensions with this backend config. That should actually be pretty quick to update, so if I go back to the load balancer here and we go to our previously failing backend, we should now see a healthy status. So now we should basically have everything we need here. We can test the system end to end by just going to our new application domain, and there it is. We've got our Kanboard application running, which is using GKE Autopilot, Certificate Manager, Google Cloud Load Balancing, and Cloud SQL. Almost all the components here are going to be Google managed. We just have that YAML file with some of our application specifications, and the rest is taken care of for us, all the way from the load balancer back to the Postgres database. This pattern can be reused for a really wide variety of Dockerized applications that need a relational database, so we hope that it will adapt well to your use case and you find value in this pattern. We'll keep an eye on the comments section for any questions, and we want to thank you for watching.